So thank you, judges, again for your time. And if you can just introduce yourselves, that would be great.
Here, I'll turn on my video. Hopefully, you can see me while I'm talking and introducing myself. Yeah, so I'm Tom Wallstrom, and I am an economist in the regional group at the Federal Reserve Bank of Chicago, and it's my job to keep track of the Midwest economy for our president, Charlie. It's changed a little bit since the pandemic started, but there's a regional memo that I write that goes to him. We've been spending a lot of time in our group talking to business leaders throughout the 7th Federal Reserve District to just keep track of what they're seeing on the ground. A big part of that, my job is talking to people who's are boots on the ground workers or business owners, and figuring out and writing the beige book is another duty of mine. So with that, I'll turn it over to Eric.
Hi, good morning, everyone. My name is Eric Larson. I am a former College Fed Challenge participant myself many, many years ago. So it is a great pleasure and honor to be here with you all this morning. I know how much work goes into your presentations and everything that you've done to get to this point. So first off, I just want to recognize that and say it's a great pleasure to meet all of you virtually and to be able to do this through a computer, given the strange times that we're in. I think the College Fed Challenge is a great program. I'm really passionate about it. It was a big part in landing me my first job at the Board of Governors. I was a research assistant for a few years, and then I stayed on full-time as I function mostly as a data scientist these days. I work in a group in the Monetary Affairs Division that supports the FOMC. So a lot of what I studied in College Fed Challenge is very real to me today in my day-to-day. So it was great to watch your all's presentation, and I look forward to learning a little bit more through this Q&A session.
Thank you, judges, for your time. If we're ready to get started, we will start the timer. Students, judges, are you ready?
Can I share my screen? Is that okay?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, if we're ready to get started, we will start the timer.
Eric, you go first.
All right, sounds good. So my first question is, the FOMC released a new statement on longer run goals and monetary policy strategy in August 2020. That new statement was the product of an 18-month long review of monetary policy strategy, tools, and communication practices that included Fed listens events around the country. The new statement makes changes to the language describing both dual mandate objectives. Why does the FOMC now describe its maximum employment goal as, quote, broad-based and inclusive, end quote, and say that its, quote, policy decisions must be informed by assessments of the shortfalls of employment from its maximum level, unquote?
Yeah, of course. So this is a really important question. Kind of like you say, this comes directly out of the Fed's new guidance. And so what we're talking about specifically is the labor markets. And the specific change in language was from maximum employment from full employment. And so this kind of comes, as you're speaking, from the need to look at a broad range of indicators in order to have a comprehensive understanding of the labor market. And so part of this study, there's a really interesting study from San Francisco Fed President Mary Daly. And so kind of the rationale behind the study is that in an economy where the unemployment rate falls below estimates of its long-run level, it can actually yield outsized gains for some women and minority groups, according to that study. And so they actually did some research and found that when unemployment fell to 4.1%, opposed to previously thought 4.4% long-run unemployment rate, that's exactly where the underrepresented community labor market started seeing a significant outsized improvement. So, for example, one set of results showed that when unemployment rate falls below its estimated long-run level, Black women and Hispanic men continue to see declines in unemployment of a greater magnitude than their white counterparts, with the multiplier that increased as the overall unemployment rate fell.
And I can build off that by mentioning two additional things. The first is that this is to some degree also in response to the COVID pandemic, which is a very unique shock in its ability to disproportionately affect certain industries and certain groups, such as low-wage earners. And due to those disproportionate effects, the Fed has had to take more inclusive employment mandate into consideration. And the second reason for doing this is what Dench already mentioned, which is, once again, a lot of minority groups generally start to see job gains towards the end of the expansion cycle, as we started to see after 2008 in 2019. And we want to be mindful of that.
And so, yeah, kind of to cap all that off, one thing that's been pretty interesting is that the Fed has found that it's able to keep rates very low without actually seeing any negative impacts to inflation. And so part of what that means is that the Fed is able to feel comfortable heating up the economy to such a degree to where we're trying to get maximum employment as opposed to full employment, because the negative consequences of things like inflation, we haven't really seen those consequences at all in the past 10 years, whereas we do see some of these benefits of trying to get the unemployment level as low as possible. You do see some of these very positive benefits, like an increase in employment for some of these minority and women groups.
All right, thank you. Unless there are any other comments from the team, I'll pass it over to Thomas.
Okay, hearing none, I'm going to second question. And let's see. So, yeah, so I, just an FYI, that these are questions we're asked. The first two questions we're asking you are for are ones that are being asked to all groups. And so after that, we'll get asked some questions that are specific to your presentation or just specific to us. So here's the second question that all groups are being asked. It is, the FOMC stated that it is, quote, committed to using its full range of tools to support the U.S. economy in this challenging time, thereby promoting its maximum employment and price stability goals. With the federal funds rate near zero, please discuss other monetary policy tools that the FOMC could have used or could use to address additional adverse shocks to the economy. If applicable, please discuss the relative costs and benefits of each tool. That's the question.
I can just start by giving a brief overview of unconventional monetary policy tools that we have to undertake after hitting the zero lower bound. Specifically, in response to this pandemic, the Fed has engaged in quantitative easing. It has engaged in forward guidance, and it has established multiple liquidity facilities to help make financial conditions more accommodative. And my teammates can start by delving into each of them.
Yeah, I can start off by, first of all, the Fed has recently announced that it will be engaging in flexible average inflation targeting in response to its persistent undershooting of inflation. And really the reason we've done this is because there were two characteristics of our previous strategy that were extremely flawed. The first is that individuals, households, and businesses perceived the 2% inflation target as an upper limit. And through pure logic, this would really lead to less than or equal to 2% inflation over time. The second risk is that preemptively raising rates without signs of inflation will place our faith in a traditional Phillips curve relationship, which may no longer exist.
Yeah, I'm happy to touch on the forward guidance piece. So the forward guidance is a tool that central banks are using to provide communication to the public about the likely course of future monetary policy. And so when these central banks provide forward guidance, businesses, consumers use that information in making decisions about today's spending and investment. So we've seen forward guidance as an effective tool to influence future economic conditions. In terms of the benefits and some of the drawbacks, the pros are that it allows the Fed to influence longer-term interest rates through expectations. But having said that, there is what's called the forward guidance puzzle, where there is a trade-off between clarity and flexibility, where issuing stringent guidance limits the ability to deal with future expected shocks. And so the stronger and longer and more comprehensive the forward guidance is, the greater probability that a central bank might be tempted to renege on it, which reduces the risk of forward guidance. And so one of the big drawbacks of forward guidance is the threat of permanent credibility damage.
And I'm happy to touch on the liquidity facilities that Gustav mentioned. So back in early March, when the fallout from the pandemic first began, we saw an incredible flight to safety in the financial markets. Credit was hard to get for many borrowers in need. Spreads widened, and issuances fell. So the Fed established some of its 13-3 facilities, including TALF, the commercial paper funding facility, the money mutual market liquidity facility, as well as others. And this really helped to backstop credit markets continue the flow of credit to borrowers in need. So I'll just talk about the money mutual fund liquidity facility as an example. So we saw exodus of funds from these mutual funds, and this facility allowed these funds to borrow money from the Fed so it can meet its redemptions, and it essentially helped to guarantee to investors that their redemptions would be met. So it helped to limit the flow of these redemptions and help to continue the access of credit to borrowers in need.
And just to cap up the discussion with our final policy tool, which we also used in 2008, which is quantitative easing. Essentially, the purpose of quantitative easing, through which we've purchased agency mortgage-backed securities, treasuries, and even corporate credit for COVID, is that we want to push down the yields on those specific assets and therefore make financial conditions more accommodative for the market participants involved within those assets. I'm happy to delve into some of the additional mechanisms through which QE transmits itself, specifically portfolio balance theory, preferred habitat theory, or signaling theory. But some of the benefits of QE is once again making financial conditions more accommodative. But one of the drawbacks is balance sheet expansion, which leads which makes it even more difficult to normalize policy in the longer run.
Great, thanks everyone. Let me just ask about average inflation as a follow-up. Can you tell me a little bit more about, I think you touched on it a little bit, but just reiterate for me kind of the costs and benefits of that tool. What's the benefits of moving to that, and what are the potential costs of moving to that new approach?
Yeah, I can start by talking about some of the benefits of that tool. So one of the big problems recently is that we've seen, you know, since the 90s, inflation on average in the United States has been 1.86%. And so because we're not consistently hitting the 2% target, the market has started to price in and expect that inflation will on average be lower. And so by adopting average inflation targeting, it gives the Fed more room to move and let inflation creep up during times where interest rates are lower and the market is in a recession. And so by giving us that additional flexibility, it also allows the Fed to cut rates further in the case of another drawback. And so it's a self-fulfilling prophecy and really anchors inflation expectations, because if inflation expectations rise, consumers will want to buy more before inflation goes up, which creates more demand, which ultimately rises inflation. And the same thing on the other side if inflation ends up falling.
Yes, and additionally, right now we are in an extremely deflationary environment. Since 1990, inflation has averaged 1.86%, which is below our target of 2%. And kind of one of the drawbacks of flexible average inflation targeting is that you are targeting inflation. And a study by Canada, Koivin and Yuri at the NBER has shown that households inherently have a flawed understanding of inflation. So across all developed countries that they studied, professional forecasters understood that a high inflation is typically associated with higher forecasts of out, of output growth. And that's really consistent with demand-driven business cycles and the Phillips curve. But in sharp contrast, households across all countries systematically have the opposite view, that high inflation is associated with worse growth forecasts. So really, when we are delivering this policy, I think it's of the utmost importance that we speak with clarity, that inflation is ultimately the desired goal that we are aiming for, especially in this economy where we're seeing low aggregate demand. We're seeing a decrease in government transfers, which is slowing the flow of money throughout the economy. And with that, we really do hope that flexible average inflation targeting will bring us to our 2% goal that we've been aiming for.
It's also really important to note that in flexible average inflation targeting, this means that, as Kira mentioned, we've been in a deflationary environment and not been hitting our 2% goal. So in order to reach 2% average rate, that means
this is the 2-minute warning. The 2-minute warning.
Thank you. Yes, absolutely. So to reach the 2% average rate, we have to let inflation go moderately above 2% for some time, which does represent somewhat of a risk because getting inflation back under control historically has been a very challenging thing for the Federal Reserve to do in the United States and also to get done globally. So there is a slight risk that if we let inflation get above 2%, trying to bring it back down to 2% could result in some recessionary or negative repercussions. So it's really important to be on top of letting the rate go above 2% and managing it very closely, potential risk.
Thank you very much. Eric, do you want to ask one last question here before we run out of time?
Yeah, I'll try and sneak one in real quick. So, of course, forward guidance was a big topic of discussion in your presentation, and we're talking about this new average inflation targeting regime. So what channels does the Federal Reserve typically use to communicate its policy decisions related to forward guidance and new tools such as this? What do they use right now? And if you get any, touch upon any benefits or drawbacks of each communication channel, that would be great.
Yes, I can start by talking about some of the channels through which the Fed uses forward guidance. So the first channel is that the Fed chair, traditionally after the FOMC meetings, will do a press conference where they take on questions and answer questions about what was discussed in the FOMC meeting, and they'll also issue a statement regarding their economic outlook and just the state of the economy in general. The Federal Reserve also publishes a policy statement, and they very recently also decided to start doing the summary of economic projections and release that with the policy statement. And lastly,
it has ended.
I'll just finish the sentence. And lastly, they also published 20 minutes.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you again for your time and for your participation in this year's virtual College Fed Challenge. This week or next week, you will receive an invitation to the winter announcement, which will take place on November 20th at 3 p.m., so please tune in for the results. Also, a press release will announce the winners that day, and a winning video presentation and the Q&A sessions will be uploaded to the board's website after the announcement. After that time, if you did not win, we will be in touch about supplying your video and Q&A sessions. So again, I'd like to thank you for your participation this year and good luck. And we're done. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Brenda.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Take care.
Thank you, everyone.
Take care.